Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. I'll speak today on the topic of three principles for inner empowerment. I'll speak on the basis of the Bhagavad Gita, 6th chapter, 5th verse, where Krishna says, Uddharet Atmanatmanam, Natmanam avasadayet, Atmaiva ya Atmano bandhur, Atmaiva ripuratmanaha. He says, elevate yourself with yourself. The word Krishna uses Atma. So elevate yourself with yourself. Uddharet Atmanatmanam. Na Atmanam avasadaye. Don't degrade yourself. Why? Because the self, Atmaivaya Atmano Bandhur. The self is the friend of the self, and the self is also the enemy of the self. Atmaiva Ripuratmanaha. Now, if we consider our own life, we all need power to do things. If it's dark, we need electric power so that we can turn on the lights. If we want to drive somewhere, we need fuel power so that we can drive our vehicle. If we want to buy things, we need financial power. If as a community or in the country we want to do something, we need political power. So all of us, if we want to do things in life, we need power. And most of our life, we try to find various means by which we can increase our power. So we may try to develop contacts with influential people so that if I can't do it myself, then I will have some influential person, they have that power and they will do it for me. So we often seek power so that we can get things done. And that's understandable. However, our greatest power is not the power we have over others. It is the power we have over ourselves. Because if we don't have that power over ourselves, then even if we get enormous power externally, so some people, if say they don't have power over themselves, they can't control their anger. They get angry and they're not able to control it. They don't have that inner power. Then if they have external power, so they have physical power. There was this boxer, Mike Tyson. He was quite physically very powerful. At one time he was fighting a championship match, he was losing the match, and he got so angry that in the fray, he got so angry with his opponent that he bit off the ear of his opponent. And then he was disqualified because of that. Nowadays, if people get angry, and they don't have inner power. So if they have no inner power and they have outer power, it becomes very dangerous. Sometimes people get angry nowadays. There are random gun shooters in schools, in public malls, in various places. People just get angry. They're angry with the world. They pick up a gun and they shoot. So for us to do good to ourselves or to good to others, we need inner power. Inner power, it can be a practical situation also. We can say that, say we want to study for an exam and we want to do well in that exam. At that time, we may think, oh, if I can get this book, if I can get this understanding, if I can meet with this professor, if I can get this, you may think, oh, if I can get this, then I can study better. That's all true. The external resources can help. But more important than that is whether we can keep a calm mind. If our mind is extremely disturbed, if you are very worried, if you are very fearful, then it's like, even if we have memorized certain facts, we just don't recollect it at that time. Like the mind, which is meant to recollect the facts, that same mind starts blocking us from recollecting the facts. So thus, if we see at a more damaging level, there is no inner empowerment, then the mind starts becoming our enemy. So depression is when the mind starts constantly telling us negative stories. this didn't work out for you, you made a mess of that, that person did like this to you. Nothing is ever going to work. So when this negative story starts coming again and again and again and again, then slowly you start feeling nothing is going to work in my life. So depression can have many circumstantial causes. It can sometimes have some physiological causes also. But essentially depression happens when the mind keeps telling something negative again and again and again and again, and we just have no capacity to resist its negative story. So the ultimate expression of lack of inner empowerment is suicide, where the mind kills the body. Where actually, again, there can be various factors which may make a person very depressed to the point of being suicidal. But others may go to the same situation and they may not become suicidal. So it is, it can even take our life, or it can make us take others' lives if we do not have power over ourselves. So power over ourselves means over our own mind. So when Krishna uses the word Atma over here, he's the word Atma can refer to the soul, but the word Atma can also refer to something which we think is me. Something that we think is me. So what do we mean by that? Many times we do something. Say we want to wake up early in the morning, and then we set an alarm to wake up early in the morning. The alarm rings, and we wake up, and something within us says, go to sleep. And then just put the snooze and go to sleep. So now, this inner voice, at that time we think, it is my voice. But afterwards, maybe we thought I'll sleep for 5 minutes, but we end up sleeping for 1 hour. And then what happens? That same mind. This is the inside voice which we identify as our voice, is the voice of the mind. And the same mind then beats us up. You fool! Why are you so lazy? You are useless. You are hopeless. You are good for nothing. You will never learn. You will never do anything in the life. So at first, it is the same mind which put us to sleep. Go to sleep. And the same mind turns around and says, why did you sleep so much? So basically, what the mind does is, it has a very deceptive double role. First, it makes us do wrong, and then it beats us up for doing wrong. And inner empowerment means that when the mind starts telling us to do things which are unhealthy, unwanted, unproductive, we need to be able to resist it. So Krishna is telling over here, elevate yourself. Then he is telling us that we should become internally empowered. So much of society today talks about empowerment. We have empowerment of, say, women's empowerment, or we have people who have been deprived in India, lower caste people, their empowerment, or here we have African American people, their empowerment. We talk about some people are disempowered and need to be empowered. All these have their importances, but the most damaging disempowerment happens because of our own mind. And the most enriching, the most defining empowerment can happen when we can learn to distance ourselves from our mind. So how do we do this? I'll talk about three broad principles. And I would like this to be a more of a discussion. So if you have any reflections, you can also speak this. And you have any questions, you can also speak this. So here I talk basically about what we mean by inner empowerment. So any comments or questions about this? Anything, any part which struck you as resonating with you? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much for choosing this topic. This was something that we were thinking about, because there are a lot of young people here, youngsters, and one of the things that my daughter was asking was, she wanted the session to be very interactive, because she couldn't sit through the whole, she was telling me, please ask the person to make it interactive, and this opportunity for us to.
So she is here?
Yes, permission.
Oh, so it is your responsibility to interact now. So feel free, if now or later, whenever you want. Thank you. Happy to do this. You wanted to say something?
How do you differentiate between when the mind says one thing at one moment and then other time it says a different thing? How do we, like, we kind of like get absorbed in that. So how do we differentiate that it is the mind playing tricks and then we try to empower the mind?
Okay, yeah, that's what we're going to do the whole class about. Yeah, it's a valuable question. So, let's move on. So, I'll speak to this in three parts, three principles. So, I'll talk about intelligence, identification, and intention. So, intelligence refers to our inner capacity by which we can discern things. Now, there can be different kinds of intelligences. Some people have very good, say, verbal intelligence, linguistic intelligence. We are trying to write one letter and we are writing it, should I write this word, should I write that word, should I do this title, should I do this? And say some people, how do I do this? Just they sit for 2 minutes and they get excellent sentence. So there can be intelligence in terms of language. Some people are very good at music. Some children, without anyone training them, they pick up a kartal and start playing it and they play it so beautifully. So that is musical intelligence. Some people have very good, you could say, aesthetic or visual intelligence. They come into a house, and as soon as they come into that house, you know, okay, you move this sofa here, you put this picture here, you move this curtain here, and it should look very beautiful. And somebody has stayed in that house for many months, they didn't think about it. As soon as they come in, they can do it. So we can have different kinds of intelligences. Now all these intelligences are valuable. But when the Bhagavad Gita talks about buddhi, it talks about a more foundational kind of intelligence. It is, if we, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about buddhi in the 18th chapter, intelligence in the three modes. He talks about it from 18.30 to 32. And then in 18.30 he states, intelligence means ravruttim cha nivruttim cha karya karye bhaya bhaye bandham moksham chaya vetti buddhi sapartha satviki. This is healthy intelligence, the intelligence in sattva guna, that is intelligence which can understand what to do and what not to do. Karya karye bhaya bhaye, this is to be done, this is not to be done. Bandham moksham chaya vetti, this will lead to bondage, this will lead to freedom. So intelligence in terms of making life's decisions. We all have particular kinds of intelligences. So some people may be very good at music, at language, at aesthetics, and this is valuable. But the intelligence that will define our life the most is our capability to take responsible decisions. Taking responsible decision means we should be able to see, okay, this if I do this, this will be the consequence. If I do this, this will be the consequence. And therefore, I need to be careful. I need to cautiously think and act. The mind often brings impulses to us. Eat this, watch this, touch this, buy this. And if we keep doing it, at one time when we do it, it seems harmless. You just take a little bit. Oscar Wilde was a British thinker. He said, giving up smoking is the easiest thing in the world. I have done it over 100 times. So, what happens is, I gave up smoking, but smoking did not give me up. So, usually when we do an action, we think of that action just in isolation. I feel like doing it, so I'll do it. But every action is unconsciously a commitment to the similar actions in future. Every action is an unconscious commitment to similar actions in future. That means, say somebody smokes once, somebody drinks once, somebody takes drugs once. It's not just a one-time event. It is a one-time event, but what happens when the mind prompts us, each action like that will cause the mind to prompt like that again and more forcefully, more forcefully. And when it keeps prompting more forcefully like that, they become stronger and stronger and stronger. So we could say that the mind is like a software. Say if you have your browser And suppose somebody has visited a particular site in that browser repeatedly. Say somebody has visited Bollywood.com. So they visited again and again and again and again. And then, now they come to a spiritual program, they hear about Bhagavad Gita. Hey, Bhagavad Gita sounds interesting, let me find out what is this Bhagavad Gita. And they go in their browser and they type B. And what happens?
Bollywood.
Yes, Bollywood automatically comes up. Now they had no intention to go to Bollywood.com. But because they had chosen that repeatedly, that gets stored in the history. And that comes as an autocomplete. So, just as the browser's history, the software there, stores each choice and then makes that choice easier for us in future. Similarly, whenever we do any action, that action creates an impression in the mind. Here's the action, every action creates an impression. And that impression comes as a proposition. Do it again. It's like Bollywood.com comes as a proposition. Now we can still go to Bhagavad Gita.com, but we will have to consciously type the full word. But if you don't type it, just keep B, it'll go to Bollywood. So like that, each action we do is a commitment to, is an unconscious commitment to similar actions in the future. And that's why if we don't choose our actions carefully, if we don't use our intelligence to understand that an action is not just an isolated action. An action is a part of a chain by which that action gets repeated again and again and again. So intelligence means to see the consequence of the action. Intelligence means what? If this action is going to lead to this consequence. But when we are not very intelligent, we see that action isolation. Once I do, what is the big deal? Nobody ever thinks that I want to become a drunkard. Nobody thinks that I want to become an alcoholic or a drug addict or anything. I think, let me do it once. What is the big deal? But at once can become again and again and again. So intelligence means to understand how the mind prompts us. It's a proposition that is coming from the past impression. Some action I did in the past that created an impression, and that impression is coming as a proposition. So when that proposition comes, I have to be conscientious enough to recognize that this will lead to this consequence, and therefore I don't want to do this. Conversely, positively also, sometimes you may not feel like doing something. Say, we may not feel like studying scripture, we may not feel like doing some exercise, we may not feel like doing mantra meditation. But if we do it, each action is an unconscious commitment to similar future actions. So when we do it once, that starts becoming stored as an impression. So intelligence, we need to equip ourselves with intelligence to be able to see the consequence of our actions. Sometimes people say seeing is believing. Have you heard this saying? Mm-hmm. Seeing is believing. Now, seeing is believing is actually animal philosophy. Why animal philosophy? Say if there's a deer or some other animal lost in a desert and they see a mirage. They believe the mirage. And they believe the mirage, they keep running after it, and they never get to it. The oasis might be in the opposite direction, but they keep going in that direction. So actually, we don't just see with our eyes. We see with our intelligence that enables us to make sense of what we are seeing with our eyes. Suppose somebody has no understanding of stock markets, of the way modern business works. And they come into a stock market when there is a sudden crash in the market. And it's a big screen on which the stock index in DOW or India BSE or whatever is there. And that has crashed down. And now as it crashes down, everybody catches their head. Some people start getting hyperventilating, some people are getting a heart attack. And this person says, what is this? Just a line went down. Why are you so worried? So only a line went down. But intelligence enables us to make sense of what we see. If there is no intelligence over there, it is just a line going down. And intelligence means, what does it mean? What does it imply? What will it lead to? So similarly for us, we need to equip our intelligence so that we can understand how our mind works. So intelligence means to see the consequences of our actions. And thereafter, to choose our actions wisely. That part I'll come to a little later. But at this stage, when talking about intelligence means to take decisions responsibly. To not just give in to some prompting which comes within, I feel like doing it, so let me do it. No, we have to create positive impressions within us and avoid creating negative impressions. And this intelligence is, sometimes we may feel, oh, I don't have very good memory, I don't have good, very good verbal skills, I don't have good public speaking skills, or whatever. We may all feel I'm deficient in this or that or that. That may be there. That intelligence we may or may not be able to develop. But this intelligence to discern and decide is something which each one of us can develop. And how do we develop it? By studying scripture. Studying the Bhagavad Gita, studying Shastra, that nourishes our intelligence. Shastra helps us to see the connection between action and the consequence. And thereby, okay, this is how my mind works, this is what I should do. This is what I should not do. Without scriptural knowledge, we rule, if we are told to do rules, do this and don't do this. It just seems restrictive. Why should I not do this? Why should I do this? So rules can simply seem restrictive if our intelligence is not nourished. If somebody is told, don't take drugs. Why not? I feel high after that. Oh, you feel high after that, but you feel terrible after that. Many times people take drinks, and literally when Krishna says that which tastes like nectar in the beginning will taste like poison in the end. So when people take drinks, they go high. But after that, they have a hangover. Then they get a splitting headache. It's miserable. So to be able to see the consequence of the action, that is intelligence. And with all our education today, we are not provided this intelligence. We get intelligence maybe of science, of technology, of IT, of this, that. We get all that intelligence that's useful. Functionally, it's valuable. But foundationally, this is the intelligence that is going to define our life. And this intelligence is provided by scripture. The more we study scripture, the more we start understanding how the mind is working. And then we can evaluate and we can correct ourselves. So the mind will, when the mind starts disempowering us by making us habituated to unwanted things or by making us reluctant to desirable things, then if our intelligence is strong, then we'll understand, okay, this action is what I should do even if I don't feel like it. This action I should not do even if I feel like, even if I, this action I should do even if I don't feel like doing it, this action I should not do even if I feel like doing it, whatever, the particular actions. So the nourishing the intelligence is vital for us to be able to live life effectively. So any comments from this point or questions?
Yes. You said that like to choose and decide what to do and consciously making decisions and to make the conscious decision we should read scriptures. That's what you're talking about. But like youngsters are not like really conditioned to read scriptures. Like if you say scriptures, they feel boring. Even for some time, like, you know, when I, in my initial days, like scriptures are boring to me. I'm not a reading guy. So what are the other easy alternatives that, you know, I understand scriptures are good, like it's going to
I get the point. So especially when we are young and somebody, the kids, they will not read scripture. That's why scripture principles are taught through scriptural stories. If we hear the Mahabharata, we hear the Ramayana, but we don't hear them just as stories. If we study the Bhagavad Gita and study the Mahabharata, we'll actually see the Mahabharata as demonstrating the principles of the Bhagavad Gita. If we have the philosophical understanding, then we study the stories. The stories are much more entertaining. So that way, That can help. I have given a series of about 75 classes on the Mahabharata, all the characters, 30 minute talks, and I've explained their lives, the biographies, and certain controversies resolved. Why did this happen like this? Why did that happen like that? And I've given practical lessons for our life also. So there are other devotees also who have explained the epics. So basically, we talk about ethics from epics. We just talk about ethics. It is not very interesting. It seems too didactic. If we talk only about epics, it's only entertainment. But when you talk about epics and talk about ethics through epics, then it becomes empowering. That's one way. And also, we need to... it's not... Generally, most... If you look at even the tradition itself, the tradition has been primarily an oral tradition. You see, before Gutenberg invented the printing press, books were very rare. Because people would hardly ever read books. So it was mostly the spiritual wisdom was disseminated through the oral tradition, through speaking and through hearing. So now we have many, if you look on the internet, there are many devotees. Not every devotee has the vibhuti of speaking very attractively. But some devotees have that. So if we find some devotees who speak attractively and they can connect with the youth, then we can encourage them to hear that. Generally, reading is scripture. When I talk about scriptural study, Shastra, its individual study is required, but it is much more difficult. It is hearing scriptural wisdom from scriptural teachers, from contemporary scriptural teachers. That's what helps. Okay. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
One comment I heard through about this intelligence somewhere, I don't know, Prabhupada said that you chant Hare Krishna and you become intelligent. So what's the connection? I suppose, you know, someone who doesn't read scriptures simply chant for the name.
Can I answer? This will be answered later on as we move forwards. How there's a role of purification. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, that's true.
So how can we arrange both of them? Because without telling them what is good and bad, because they are not in that situation, and that they can decide themselves. So if at all we don't enforce, how
they're
going to
do that? I understand. So at one level we say we should not enforce any things on children, but at the same time their intelligence is not good enough to understand things. Actually, we'll be surprised at how intelligent children are. We presume that they are not intelligent enough, but if we try to explain things properly to them, see, the problem is often not that they are not intelligent enough, that they often feel that when we explain certain things to them, we have an agenda behind that. That you are telling me this because you want me to do this. So when I started practicing bhakti about 20-25 years ago, I asked a senior Vaishnava, how do I preach to my parents? So Jayadvait Maharaj told me that by letting anyone except you preach to them. So what happens many times when there are certain things, I have a particular dynamic in my relationship. So everything that I speak will be filtered through the dynamic of that relationship. So that's why we need to have, there is vertical education, there is lateral education. Lateral education means that if we can have, say, Sunday school classes, or we can have other programs where kids can interact with other kids and they can have somebody whom they can connect with, some other devotee in the community who is not necessarily of the parent generation, but not necessarily of their generation, somewhere in between. somewhere whom they can connect with, somebody who is successful in their career in terms of the kids can relate with. So then we don't have to, we may have to equip the intelligence of our children, but we don't have to think that we alone have to do it. So in general, if our children feel that we care for them, that it's not just that, you know, we are following this culture and therefore we want our children to follow this culture. Actually, if they feel we care for them, and if they feel that if they themselves become convinced about why what they should do, why this should be done, this should not be done, then it's much easier for them to practice it. So Srila Prabhupada told one of his disciples who was going for college preaching, he said that the worst thing that you can do in your college outreach is present Krishna consciousness as a set of rules. Krishna consciousness is a profound philosophy. If we look at our own lives and we look at the lives of our children, then our children have a disadvantage in a sense. They have an advantage that they grew up in a devotional culture with devotional impressions. But the disadvantage is that for most of us, the philosophy came first and the practices came later. We might even have been in a pious family where we are doing some amount of bhakti. But now we are practicing bhakti much more seriously. And we are practicing it because we got convinced about the philosophy. So for us, the philosophy came first, the practices came later. But for the children, the practices come first. Even when they go to classes, they may even sit and hear classes. Generally in a Sunday school, we may just talk about some Krishna stories or memorizing some shlokas, which also seems to be like another to-do. You know, I have to do this, I have to do this, I have to do this. I have to memorize this formula in my school and I have to memorize the shlokas in the temple. This becomes another to-do. Now, when the kids come to their teenage, generally maybe 13, 14, 15, 16, at that time their intelligence has started developing quite a bit. So they need systematic education and philosophy. It may be that I have met with devotee children and I talk with them privately. Some their parents are preachers who have some hundreds of people come for their programs. And the son has doubt whether even God exists. And the son is a bad person. It's just that was never rationally explained to them. So we need to have, just like we have for new people, we may design some courses or have some systematic presentation of the philosophy. So like that, there needs to be a time when there is an intellectual engagement with the philosophy and intellectual acceptance of the philosophy. There is, for them, it's more of their all engagement with bhakti is largely cultural engagement. Now worship this deity, offer this lamp, play this kartal, and all that is good, that's nice. But there has to be an intellectual engagement with the bhakti tradition. Now, how exactly we create that, that's up to them. Depends on our situation. But it's important to do that. The impressions that we are given, they will definitely stay. But if there is no intellectual engagement with the practices, intellectual understanding of the practices, then one starts feeling, why should I do this? Because we start feeling, okay, there are so many ways to this, I can do this, this I can do this, I can do this, and there's so much enjoyment is there. Why should I deprive myself? So that we cannot impose the philosophy, but we do have to present the philosophy in a way that they can connect with. Okay? Thank you.
So we impose the policy and we impose the things, but it usually takes time. Happen gradually, right? So how much rigid we should be that, okay, my daughter or my son should follow this. If he or she is not following that, then there is some kind of a big gap between father and son. So we know that, okay, they're going to follow it, but definitely it will happen gradually. It will not happen all at once. So should be rigid in that scenario, or we should be a little bit flexible? Okay, let's say he's going to the market, he's eating a cake, right? And it should be rigid enough, okay, no, you cannot eat it, and it's like a situation where they are getting angry over the parents and something like that. So how much rigidity
yeah.
we should involve while making them learn? And
that's true. That's a good question. So how rigid should we be? See, in general, in today's world, as soon as something is forbidden, it becomes more fascinating. As soon as you tell, don't do this, why should I want to do it? It's in India, in fact, there was a whole controversy. There was some movie about some Rajasthani king or something.
Padmavati.
It became Padmavati. So, there's a big agitation to ban it. And then it came in the news. You know, why this should be banned, this should not be banned, this is against the Rajput pride and this, all that. And eventually, when it was released afterwards, it came out that actually the producers themselves had orchestrated the whole ban to create publicity. And that's why that same organization which had agitated against the thing, this is against Rajput pride, they said, no, it's actually not against Rajput pride. So they withdrew their agitation. So whatever. So the point is that actually banning something in today's world just doesn't work. As soon as I said, don't do this, why not? That's the question that comes up. So it's best to provide education. See, broadly speaking, we can provide people only three things. Anyone, each soul has free will. And every soul will use their free will in their own way. What we can provide them is three things. We can provide them enlightenment, engagement, and encouragement. Enlightenment means, if you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. Just give them the knowledge of what are the consequences. So, actually, I would say that with respect to food, talking about why meat eating is bad, there is becoming vegan is quite cool in today's culture. So if you provide resources to them, you can still make the decision. It's emotionally, logically, it's all quite persuasive. There are a lot of resources over there. So first is enlightenment. Just tell the consequences of the actions and help them, not just we tell them, but help them see it for themselves. It's like I tell you, this is a ditch, don't go there. But if you are not seeing the ditch, you still want to explore. Let's say if I take my specs out, you see this, hear this, and there's a ditch, I should not go there. So basically, it's like, don't tell me, show me. So that's enlightenment. Second is engagement. Engagement means, if I should not do this, what should I do? So we need to, if somebody wants to eat cakes, then have equally tasty alternatives which do not have eggs. So basically, if you tell somebody don't do something, what can I do? We need to have adequate devotional engagements. So there is drama, there is music, there is art. So if we create devotional engagements, then there is something for them to do. I don't want to do this, I want to do this. But what is the facility for me to do this? And third is encouragement. Encouragement means, in general, we tend to catch people when they do wrong. But we need to catch them when they do right and appreciate. So it's like sometimes in parenting, we become like spectators and the child is like a goalkeeper. When the goalkeeper is there, the goalkeeper may save 100 goals. But people remember only the goal, that ball that passes by them. Isn't it? you missed that ball and that goal was scored. So sometimes it becomes like that. They may be doing the right thing 100 times. But one time they do the wrong thing, immediately, why did you do that? So if we appreciate them when they are doing the right thing, and then we provide them the inner support, the moral encouragement, then it becomes easier for them to do it. Yes.
On the context of the own question, since we are talking about the one catching on the one bad goal, so in different situations, the whole day might be going right, but some one thing goes on, then the mind holds on to that and makes you feel that, the total thing is useless, my life, day has gone bad, or it's holding on to that thing, that one thing that went bad. So how do we retain it to bring attention to all the small things that happen, so be grateful for that?
Yeah, so if one thing has gone wrong, then how can we and that makes it, that spoils our whole day for us.
Yeah.
So how do we avoid that? Yeah, I have tomorrow evening in Baltimore, I'm speaking on this topic of counting our blessings. So I'll give you a preview of that here. So basically, we can look at, I use the acronym ACE. Ace your life with gratitude. ACE is ACE. That whenever anything bad happens in our life, it's very difficult to be positive about the bad thing. We can't be grateful for all situations, but we can be grateful in all situations. How? But if something bad has happened, look for A is around. Look for the good around the bad. If this bad thing happened, but in all these things also are right in my life. So we have to make a habit of counting our blessings, writing down the things that are good in our life, and keep that ready with us. So, okay, you know, my health is good, this is good, this is good, my financial situation is okay, I'm practicing bhakti, culturally I'm good, good situation. This. Note it down, because at that time it will be very difficult to remember. So one is count your blessings and keep them ready. The good around the bad. Then C is, A is around, C is counter. The good that helps us to counter the bad. Okay, this bad thing has happened, but okay, even this bad thing has happened, I got this disease, I got this bad diagnosis, but overall my body is healthy, I got health insurance, I got a supportive family, I got a good community around me, I got a good doctor, the disease is curable. So what is the good that helps me to counter the bad? And E is emerge. What is the good that may emerge from the bad? This bad thing, we can't imagine the bad to be good, but we can wait and watch. We can be patient rather than judging the situation, labeling the situation. Yes, this bad thing happened, but let me wait. Something good might emerge from it. So basically, even if we can't be grateful for all situations, we can be grateful in all situations. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Like, whatever we eat, our kids, like we said, food habits and all. But when they get information from external sources, from school, those are opposite to that. So
like what?
How we opposite? Say not to eat outside food or egg or meat, all these. But in schools, they have protein, you should eat and eat for them. So what the teacher teaches to the kids, that will more solidify into their mind. And when they come up and say, okay, my teacher told me that.
Mm-hmm.
Like that. And at that time, we don't have very much answer to explain that, to neutralize that. So, how we should handle
it? Yeah, it's a practical challenge, practical problem. Suppose in the education system, we get learned something which is contrary to what they learn in our tradition. What the children learn like that. And how do we go ahead? I would say that in some ways, the education can broaden our vision also. But in some ways, the education, what we learn in the syllabus in schools, or what we learn with our teachers, may be a few decades behind the latest science. It is not that today's science will come in tomorrow's textbooks. It may take years. So specifically with respect to protein, there is well-documented research that that we can get abundant proteins even from vegetarian food. In fact, there is protein and there is what doctors call as a protein utilization factor. So when we take in meat, we take in a lot of protein, but the body itself cannot process that much protein. That's why it passes out. So it's possible that there can be protein deficiency in vegetarian food, but there are supplements and there are specific items within vegetarian food which if you take, we get adequate proteins. So it's a specific, as far as facts are concerned, naturally what we learn from school will be authoritative, but it may not be conclusive, it may not be definitive. There is some amount of authority in it. So we can't just say this is what our tradition says and that's why we do it or don't do it. We have to find out similar sources which will also support what our traditions say. And I have an article on my website, The Spiritual Scientist, where I talk about help the world with your food. How what we eat can help the world. So HELP is the acronym. So I talk about how vegetarian food is better for our health. It is better for the environment. It is better for livestock. The animals themselves don't have to suffer. And it is actually a way to decrease poverty in the world. because the existing natural resources are better utilized. So there are, whatever objections are there, there are rational cases to counter that. So let's move on now. So we discussed about, what did we discuss about?
Intelligence.
So second part I said is?
Engagement.
Yeah, engagement was something else. It was on it was enlightenment, engagement and encouragement. Good, you remember that. Thank you. Then we'll talk about identification. So what do I mean by identification? See, basically, for us, the mind tends to be tricky. It's not easy for us when the mind prompts something. Immediately, eat this, watch this, do this. Then at that time, to immediately say, oh, this is the mind speaking and this is undesirable, all that processing is not that easy. So we need to identify typical ways in which our mind tricks us and then catch it that time. Some people, they are not morning people. And then they wake up, they are irritable. They're not normally irritable people, but when they wake up, maybe for a half an hour, 1 hour, 2 hours, they're in a bad mood. And if somebody knows that this person is not a morning person, then they wake up, whatever they speak, they will not take it very seriously. If they grumble, if they yell, they moan, okay, and they'll overcome it. So, you know, when we understand that, okay, this is the character of this person, then we learn to accept it and move on with life. So similarly, if we identify, our mind has typical patterns. So the mind can trick us in many ways, but it's not that the mind tricks us in a new way every time. There are standard ways in which the mind tricks us. So some people have a tendency to get depressed. So one thing goes wrong and the mind starts saying, this went wrong, that went wrong, everything is going to go wrong. Everything is going to go wrong. Or some people, for them, their mind makes them feel lonely. Now, if you call someone and that person doesn't respond to a phone, maybe they don't care for me. Nobody cares for me. I'm all alone. So what happens? The mind has typical ways in which it tricks us. So if we can identify that means give it a label. Right? This is, okay, now the mind has started telling its loneliness story. Like, there are some people, they are very autobiographical hearers. Autobiographical hearers means you tell them, oh, actually, I went there and I got lost. It's so difficult for me to find my way back. And you start off, I got lost. And they say, oh, you know, 25 years ago, I got lost. And then this happened. So this is what autobiographical hearing. That means anything that they hear, that is a stimulus for them to start their autobiography. And they start, okay, this happened to me. So now, if we know, sometimes some people have told that same story 50 times. And again, they want to repeat that story. So what happens? As soon as we start hearing that story, we turn off mentally. And this is what they're going to say. I've heard this story so many times. So just as we turn off from people who keep repeating the same old thing, similarly, we can turn off from our mind. Identify. This is the mind telling the story. Now, the mind is telling the loneliness story. The mind is telling the depression story. The mind is telling the resentment story. Our mind is telling the craving story. I feel like eating something or watching something or buying something. So, sometimes some people are shopaholics. Shopaholics means shop, 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 shop till you drop. Just keep shopping. And then they go into a supermarket and then buy one thing. Hey, that's also nice. And they just keep buying like that. So then, instead of labeling ourselves as shopaholics, when we start getting, let me buy this also. When that voice starts coming, this is the mind starting a shopaholic story. So basically, when that thought comes within us, identify it as the mind telling a particular story. Or sometimes I just feel bored. Something is just going on so long and I just feel so bored by it. So now, sometimes some things may be boring, but they're important. We need to do them. So instead of instead of I am feeling bored, just precede that with the mind is saying. The mind is saying I am feeling bored. Immediately our attitude will change. Say if we are attending a class and somebody comes to us, or we are doing some work and somebody says, I am feeling bored. Then if somebody else would tell us that, we would immediately give them some counsel. Yeah, but you know, it's important, just do it, it will become interesting, whatever. So what we do is, identification means treat the mind as another person. Identify the mind instead of identifying with the mind. Identify the mind, don't identify with the mind. So sometimes you may say, I'm feeling so tired. So instead of accepting that, the mind is saying, I am feeling so tired. Now we are not denying, the mind is feeling like that. And we process it. Yeah, okay, I'm tired, but you know, maybe this only 15 minutes more. I can take rest after that, or I can take a break after that. Just identifying like this, that is a very powerful way in which we can create a distance between us and the mind, and then we can evaluate. Say, we have urge, you know, I want to watch a movie, I want to surf the net, I want to do this, I want to do that. Instead of, if we say no to that, why should I say no? But just like, the mind is saying, I want to do this. The mind is saying, I want to do this. So if we are preparing for an interview or an exam, and then something within us says, I am going to fail. And I remember the first time I gave a public speaking engagement, it was almost 35 years ago, something like that. 35 years ago. So my tendency is that when I become nervous, I start speaking fast. And the more nervous I become, the faster I start speaking. So the first time I was giving a public speaking talk, and then just as I was climbing on the podium to speak, something within me said, you are going to make a mess of everything. So I didn't know what was that. Now I understand it was the mind speaking. So then I just became so nervous, and it was supposed to be a six minute talk. And I started speaking, and I started speaking very fast because I was nervous. And because I was so fast, people just couldn't connect what I was speaking. It's like sometimes we sit inside a car, and immediately the person zooms off. We are not seated properly, we don't put our seat belt, and it's zooming off. We suddenly started off. So then nobody was connecting with what I was speaking, so people not paying attention. People were looking at the watch, people looking at the door, people were looking at each other. And that made me all the more nervous. I started speaking even faster. And the result of that was, actually, it was a 6 minute talk, and I had prepared it properly for 6 minutes, rehearsed it also several times, but I finished everything in 3 minutes. And there's nothing more to do. So I remember that actually just one voice came over there. You're going to make a mess of everything. So now I realize that this is the mind saying. The mind is saying, you're making a mess. You're going to make a mess of everything. So as soon as we identify it is the mind, then, okay, is this the mind saying? I'll be cautious. I'll deal with it. But I don't have to take the mind as an expert prophet who's going to tell what is going to happen in the future. So basically, the Bhagavad Gita helps us to understand that everything inside me is not me. Inside me is another voice. And by introspection, if we typically understand, okay, this is the way the mind tricks me. It makes me feel angry, it makes me feel lazy, it makes me feel bored. Then we label that. This is a boredom story. This is the anger story. This is the depression story. Just identify that. And that can help us to deal with it. So this is the second point about identification. Any comments or questions about this?
So how do we know which is where the intelligence is coming from and where the mind is playing its tricks?
How do we know where the intelligence is coming from, where the mind is playing its tricks? In general, where something is coming from is very difficult to know. What we can know is where something is taking us. So if I do this, it's going to lead to something undesirable. if I do this, this is going to lead to something desirable. So by looking at the consequence, we can understand. This is the mind speaking, this is the intelligence speaking. Now, there is no inner flashlight which will reveal. This is a label, mind speaking, intelligence speaking. There is nothing like that. So we can look at the consequence and we can learn from experience. Last time I did this, this happened. Therefore, what this is, who is saying this is the mind speaking. This is the intelligence speaking, like that. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Identification is dependent on the intelligence, basically.
Yeah, that's why I talked first about intelligence.
Your previous point need to be clear. To identify whether things are correct or not, you need to be aware of what exactly...
That is true.
What exactly you have learned earlier, right?
That is true. Yeah, so... identification requires intelligence, no doubt about it. The identification becomes easier when... we have done use our intelligence to do some introspection. The intelligence is always functional. There is knowledge which is at the back of our consciousness, the background of our consciousness, and then knowledge in the foreground of our consciousness. Say with respect to vocabulary, it is said that we have active vocabulary and we have passive vocabulary. So sometimes we want to use a word. I just can't think what is the word I should use to speak this. And then somebody uses that word, yeah, that's exactly the word I wanted to use. So when they use the word, we understand the word. We also understand this is the right word. But we can't think of it. So that means that word is there, but it is in the passive vocabulary. It is, we could say, it is a part of our passive vocabulary. But active vocabulary means we can use it. So quite often for us, philosophy and scriptural knowledge is like our passive knowledge. It is there in the background, but it is not there in the foreground. So to get into the foreground, we have to hear regularly. We have to hear regularly, read regularly. That's how it will come into the foreground. And also, speak it to others. Maybe if you hear some class, if you find some point inspiring, just speak that. That will bring it in the foreground. Then, when that knowledge is in the foreground, the intelligence is active, then the identification becomes easier. So we'll go to the last point now. Last point was what?
Intention.
Ultimately, changing our mind will go on to take time. See, if we expect that our mind should change, our desires should change, our habits should change, and all that takes time. So even if we can't change our desires, we can change our attitude towards our desires. What do I mean? Change our attitude towards our desires. By desire, it can be a proposition coming from the mind.
Instead of self-judgment?
I'll explain that. No, intention means, what it means is that when a particular proposition comes within us, eat this, touch this, watch this, whatever. Do this. At that time, if our intention is to live a moral life, our intention is to live a principled life, then that intention will give us the force of momentum. Simple example. Say, if this is our office, this is our home. And here there is some hoarding, some billboard. Of maybe some drink, some eatery, some restaurant or whatever. Now, earlier we might have gone there and used to eat a lot, but now, okay, that's not vegetarian food, that's not food, it's not healthy food, so I don't want to eat it. Now, because we have made that decision, that doesn't mean that the billboard is going to disappear. We may have decided I'm not going to eat this, but the billboard is still going to be there. So, when the billboard is there, initially, if say it's like an electronic billboard where every day they display what we have, it's a restaurant all along the way, and they display what is there, what is on the menu today. So earlier, while passing by, we eagerly look, what is there? I want to go and eat it today. But now, if our intention is to get to work straight or get from work back to home straight, then that intention, okay, this is a distraction, I will not do this. So in general, spiritual life or any kind of positive activity, it's not so much about saying no to things. More important than saying no to something is to have something better to say yes to. If we have something better to say yes to, then if what we have to say no to becomes easier. So in the past, we might have been sitting and looking at that, maybe we were standing and looking at that billboard. What is going to come tomorrow? What is there tomorrow? But now, if you are busy going from here to here, going from here to there to here, then that intention enables us to avoid distraction. So another example to illustrate this point, that suppose somebody invites us for some social event at their home. Now, we are not interested in going there at all. Maybe just a waste of time. We're not interested in going there. But saying no to them, okay, they'll feel bad. How can I say no? It's a little difficult to say no to anyone. But if at that time we have some other engagement, oh, you know, I got this program over here, I got this event over here. When we have something to say yes to, then saying no to something becomes much easier. If we have nothing to say yes to, then saying no to things becomes very difficult. So similarly, if we strengthen our intention about what are the positive things that we want to do in our life. So in general, saying no to anything creates a sense of deprivation. So nowadays, some people get device addiction. Just every 5 minutes they want to look at any new message, any new message, any new message. And on average, even in the workplace, I find that almost a lot of time goes in just surfing emails or surfing for the latest updates on their social media or on their whatever apps they are using for communicating. So now, to avoid this kind of distraction, if we are doing something which is important and our intention to do that is very strong, then saying no to the other things becomes much easier. So ultimately, bhakti yoga, when we practice bhakti, it's not about saying no to things. It's about saying yes to things. Krishna says, saying no as a policy will not work for a long time. Vishaya vinivartante mirahārasya dehina rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishtvāni vartate. When you say no, we always feel deprived. It's like a nirahārasya. We feel as if I'm not getting food. I'm starving. But param drishtvāni vartate. When we get something positive to do, then it becomes easier. So, instead of saying, I don't want to do this, we can try to strengthen our intention of what we want to do. That means, we all feel that there are so many things which I could do in my life. Now I can read this, I can learn this, I can do this. There are so many things which we want to do in our life. And many of them are positive. We just feel, if I had time, I would do it. But let's see how we can create that time for ourselves. And how can we create that time? By ensuring that our time doesn't get distracted. So much time goes in distraction. And to avoid that, we need to strengthen our intention. So try to think of what is it that I can say yes to. Now we may say, that, okay, in bhakti there are so many activities. There is chanting, there is hearing, there is this, that. That's all good. I'll conclude with this point. Rupa Goswami says, in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, he talks of a concept called Uddipan. Uddipan means spiritual stimulus. So, each one of us is an individual. And we all, because of our individuality, we are attracted to different things. So, everybody likes to eat. But, depending on where they are coming from, they may get excited about a particular food. Say, South Indian may get excited about dosa or idli sambar. Punjabi may get excited about parathas. Gujarati may get excited about dhoklas. So, now, if somebody is from some other place where they don't know about that food, then that may not trigger so much desire. Okay, that's nice food, but okay, I don't want it right now. So, just as with respect to material life, there are certain objects that excite us and certain objects don't excite us. They're all food, they're all nourishing. But certain things excite us, certain things don't excite us. Similarly, in bhakti, there we can find out, in the positive activity that we are doing in our life, we can find out what excites us. So, Some of us may find, okay, now reciting verses, I love it very much. Or hearing kirtans, I like it very much. Singing kirtans, I love it very much. Or maybe hearing this devotee's talks, memorizing these quotable quotes. This is very stimulating. So, when we find out something which is a uddipan for us, uddipan means a positive spiritual stimulus, then doing that becomes easy for us. If we just say, you know, chant Hare Krishna, worship the deities, or read Bhagavad Gita, all that is good. But you do not feel like doing it. We have to find out within bhakti, this is the circle of things which are of bhakti. And this is a circle of things which I like. Find out somewhere where the two intersect. And if we can situate, if we can make that as an activity, that is our default activity. As soon as I get some time, I will do this. Then what will happen? We will have something to say yes to. So, last year when I had come to America, I was at a devotee's house and they're telling that their son is a young boy, maybe 10, 12 years old. And he's brilliant at robotics. He's brilliant at robotics. And he is participating in national competition in robotics and he's won awards. So they're telling that he's so good at robotics. I was talking with him, brilliant he was. But then they said that, but when we try to interest him in spirituality, he has no interest at all. We tell him about Bhagavad Gita or anything, no interest, so what to do? Then I told him that, okay, I was talking with him, so I asked him that when you have this robotics competition, how do you decide what robot you'll make? Because most of the times we make robots which will lift up things efficiently, because Amazon is the biggest user of robots right now for their packing. So I said, okay, that's interesting. So he said, would you like to have some new idea for making a robot? I said, okay, yeah, what is it? Now you could make a robot of Krishna and Arjuna. Krishna speaking the Bhagavad Gita and Arjuna asking questions. First take it, no. And then we talked for a few minutes, he walked away. And then I was talking with his parents, and then after 15 minutes he came back, 10-15 minutes, and he said, actually, that's a good idea. He says, nobody will do like this. So, I will be doing something unique. Then, okay. And then we talked for some time about what questions he could ask, what questions he could answer. And then, after that, when his parents called me once and we were talking, so he told me that now he started reading the Bhagavad Gita so seriously. Because Bhagavad Gita is not interested so much in what Bhagavad Gita says to apply in his life, but to apply it is robotics. So the point is that everybody has some interest. So Krishna consciousness is not just a set of activities. Do this, do this, do this, do this. It is, there are some activities. But Krishna consciousness also means that we become conscious of Krishna through what we are naturally conscious of. What we are naturally inclined to be conscious of, we become conscious of Krishna through that. Everyone's deepest experience is their experience of Krishna. They may not know that they're experiencing Krishna. Some musician is there, they're playing music. If you get one note right, they may spend hours. Now what is there in that music? Actually, they're experiencing Krishna. They just don't know it is Krishna. So, rather than telling people your experience, this is material you're attached to, and just give it up. Chant Hare Krishna. No. Whatever is their deepest experience, help them to connect that with Krishna. So Prabhupada did that expertly in his kirtans in the early days. All kinds of people playing all kinds of musical instruments would come and Prabhupada would welcome all of them and participate in kirtans. Get them to. So that way, we can have this dynamic understanding of bhakti that sometimes the uddipan can be directly devotional. Sometimes the uddipan may not seem to be devotional, but it can be devotionalized. And then we do things in this way that we try to create a positive intention for us to do something constructive. Not just say no to something destructive or distracting. Then our energy becomes channeled positively. And as this intention becomes stronger, then that creates positive impressions within us. So, it's going back to that example of Bhagavad Gita versus Bollywood. So, if somebody chooses Bhagavad Gita once, twice, thrice, four times, five times, then eventually what is going to happen? Bhagavad Gita will become the default choice. So as soon as I type B, Bhagavad Gita will come. So like that, what we need to do is, we need to make our intention strong to do something positive. We keep saying, I will not do this, I will not do this, don't do this, don't do this. If we tell others, it's not going to work. But if you focus on, do this. And encourage them, and not just do something which they don't feel like doing. Find out something which they feel like doing, and start doing that. Then that positive intention will bring a positive connection for us, and that will bring satisfaction. And once that we experience some satisfaction in doing something positive, then the sense of deprivation that comes because of not doing something negative, that will go away. And then doing the positive will become much more easier, much more effortless. That's the time when Krishna says, the mind will become our friend instead of being our enemy. So I'll summarize. So I spoke today about the theme of equipping of three principles for inner empowerment. I talked about how we work so much to increase our external power, whether it is fuel power, electric power, financial power, political power. But the power that matters most to our life is our inner power. Because this inner power enables us to use outer power properly. Otherwise, without inner power, the more the outer power we have, the more we will hurt ourselves or hurt others. Like somebody may shoot someone else if they get a gun. Somebody may bite someone's ears off in their anger. Or if you don't have inner power, you may get depressed. We may hurt ourselves, we may even become suicidal. So inner power means that we learn to manage our mind better. And I talked about three principles for that. What are the three principles? First was intelligence. So intelligence can be of different kinds, but we are talking about the decision-making intelligence. And intelligence means to see the consequences of our actions. And with intelligence, we understand that every action is not just an isolated action. It is an unconscious commitment to similar actions in the future. It's like the software of our mind. A particular option is chosen. It becomes stored and it comes as auto-complete in the future. Like somebody choosing going to Bollywood repeatedly and then wanting to go to Bhagavad Gita, but Bollywood comes as auto-complete. So intelligence is nourished by scriptural study. And scriptural study largely means hearing in a way that we can connect with and appreciate. And second was?
Identification.
That means the mind, we can treat the mind as a person different from us. Let's say some people may be always negative when they wake up in the morning. Then we identify, okay, this is just, they do behaving like that. So we identify the typical stories of the mind. This is the depression story. This is the loneliness story. This is the hunger story. And like that, also, whenever some feeling comes up within us, we can say this, I'm feeling angry. No, the mind is saying, I'm feeling angry. That way we can, by distancing ourselves from it, we can process it properly. We can counsel the mind and choose a proper decision. And last was?
Intention.
And then I talked about how the focus should not be on, don't do this, that creates deprivation. But focus we can on doing something positive. And the mind is like an advertising agency. Just because we stop eating a particular food doesn't mean the billboard for that food will go away. The mind will keep promoting it. But if we have a positive intention, go from here to there, then we don't pay much attention to whatever is there on the billboard. So to create that positive intention, we have to look at not just what is important, but also what we like to do. So the intersection between, say, bhakti and our likes, that can be our uddipan. And then when we make it a habit to do this, then because we like to do it, so we'll do it easily. And we do it once, we do it twice, we do it thrice, then that will become the default impression within us. And then when the healthy option becomes the default impression, our mind will become our friend. And then we will become internally empowered to act constructively and successfully in our life. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So, is there any one question anyone has? Or you have? How much time do we have for questions? It's 8 o'clock now, 8:07.
Quick, maybe.
Okay, sure.
we all have different degree of intelligence, and based on that we make decisions at some point, and those decisions lead to think, oh, why did I do this? And that create an impression, negative impression in mind, saying that, oh, I did that. So what are some of the things we can overcome from those negative impressions? Because the degree of intelligence, every individual has a different one.
Yeah, see, intelligence doesn't just mean knowing what to do. Intelligence also means knowing what to do when we don't know what to do. That means, intelligence means knowing our limitations. So sometimes you need to consider this. Say for example, if you are driving along a familiar road, I don't need any GPS, I don't need any map. Just go along. But suppose there's a new road construction and the road is now somewhat unfamiliar, confusing. Then we need to consider GPS. So for certain decisions, if we just look at our own life, we understand I'm good at these things. These decisions I can make soundly. But these, I need to consult others. I need to take input from others. And then I can decide. So we ourselves, so one aspect of intelligence is recognizing where we need to consult someone else. We can say that, of course, we should consult our spiritual guides for everything. It's true, but there are certain functional things which we can do with our own God-given intelligence. So acknowledging our limitations is also a part of our intelligence. And in general, intelligence can help us in three ways. Say, intelligence helps us to prevent mistakes. Okay, this is not a healthy thing. Intelligence helps us to prevent repetition of mistakes. And the third is, intelligence helps us to recognize when we have repeated a mistake. Sometimes some people keep doing the same thing and they don't even learn from it. So, we don't have to expect that we will never commit mistakes. It is the very essence of being human is being finite. And being finite means sometimes we go wrong. So sometimes we make the right decisions and sometimes we make the decision right. What is it we make the decision right? Okay, I took a wrong decision. But now, how can I make the best of this? So it's like sometimes we are supposed to take a right turn on the road, but we take a left turn. Then you don't keep beating ourselves up. Why did I take the right turn? Why did I take the left turn? Why did I take the left turn? Okay, now take the right turn and move back. So we don't have to see any particular decision as catastrophic. At that time, a wrong decision can seem catastrophic. But in the long run, we realize that life goes on. And it's not, maybe it may have consequences, and if you could avoid it, that's good. But if you can't, it's not that anything is life ending. You can still do course correction and more. And in general, if there are certain situations in which we know that we make wrong decisions, we tend to do wrong, then it's good to try to create a pause button for ourselves. That means when somebody does something like that, I get angry and I yell at them. I don't want to do that. So then, whenever I start noticing, I'm going to get angry now. Okay, let me move out of the situation. Let me chant Hare Krishna. Let me recite some verses. Let me just maybe do something else. So it's like when we're driving first time on the road, we don't know there's a bump, we'll get jolted. But second time when we near that bump, okay, there's a bump over, we slow down. So like that, we learn from our experience. And we try to create a pause button for ourselves. Does that address your question?
Thank you.
Yes, please. Last question.
It's wonderful application about the robotic student will be able to do those things. So is there any working application that like most of the kids are like watching TV or like watching videos or games or something like that? Is there any good application that like encouraging them that they like and we can still
in Krishna consciousness? Yeah, so most kids are into video games and TV like that. I think we are moving to that direction. There are TV shows and TV programs that are spiritual. We have Little Krishna, which was made by some devotees. There are some devotees who are also working towards making video games, which are having more of a Krishna-centered. One devotee who's working on a video game which involves like going through the 8.4 million species. You take this decision, you'll go here. You take this decision, you'll go into this species. And then there are, you can become a various, it's quite a creative game. He showed me, he's working on it. So I think if some of the creativity that we use to create facilities like that, or just create a challenge. I was at a temple and the kids were not interested in coming to the temple very much. So then the temple, the youth leader, they told them that, now we plan to make our temple green. So, can you do that? So children learn a lot about environmental consciousness in the school. So they took that up. And they started coming to the temple just to make sure. They will come to the temple and make sure that everything is green over there. So there's another place where I went for a program, where he is telling that this devotee was doing a college program. And there are a lot of people coming to the college for the program. Coming to the college program, but they've never come to the temple. Tell them we have this speaker, we have this program, but they've never come. And one day then he told them that, would you like to come to the temple to serve free vegetarian food to 300 people? So, now, almost 90% of the kids came for it. They did not come to hear a lecture. But in today's youth, there is a zeal for activism. Like, I want to make a difference. I want to do something positive. So they came to the temple, and many of them liked the atmosphere. They came not to hear a talk, but they came here to do something. So although earlier I said that we need philosophical education, but that is systematically catered for them. It's expecting them to hear normal classes. It's not that easy. But in general, if there is no involvement, there is no commitment. So we need to create ways for involvement. And kids themselves are actually quite creative. So if we sit and talk with them and ask them and discuss with them, rather than judging and telling, you're playing so much video game, that's bad. Just put that judgmental attitude aside and try to understand what in the video game interests. And then we can come up with ideas. I'm sure that devotees are working in this direction. And sometimes even the kids themselves, when they grow up, at the age of 15, I'll conclude with this. I told yesterday this quote. It's a British, I think it is Mark Twain who said this, that when I was 15, my father was a fool. Now I'm 25, and I'm amazed how much the old guy has learned in the last 10 years. So it is the father may also learn in 10 years, but the way the child person thinks at 15 and the way the person thinks at 25 itself is different. So in one way, for us to think of creative engagements for say 15-year-old kids is difficult. But if somebody who has gone through that and has now become a little more mature, stable, then they can come up with this. So that's what I said earlier, that the world has changed so much in the last 20, 30 years, that it's almost like half a generation is like two generations. It's radically changed. So sometimes we cannot even connect with the way other people think. So we need a little bit of a bridge where those who have gone through that phase, but now they have outgrown it, they can come up with ideas. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki jai. Gaur Bhaktavind ki jai. Jai Gaur Premanande.
Jai. Shri Prabhupada ki jai.